Thank you for the invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here with you. I think I participated in the first activity that the CDT of Bristol organized several years ago, the QUIL. That was a very satisfactory activity. I hope this one also works well for you, the students, but also for the potential employers. So I'm the head of quantum computing at the Hitachi Cambridge Laboratory, and I would like to give you a little bit of an overview of what we do. But before we go into that, I wanted to tell you a bit more about what to expect when you get into this field. What are the differences that you may find with a job in industry with respect to a job in academia. So I come from a humble background, from a small city in Pamplona, in Spain, where we used to run in front of bulls and lift 200 kilo rocks. And I ended up being the head of a quantum computing group at a major corporation. But in the way from there to the end, I found this question. I didn't know whether to continue in academia. I did a PhD in Cambridge. So at that point, after finishing, I didn't know whether I wanted to continue there or move into industry. So I evaluated several things. And I think here I can give you a summary of what to expect. At the University of Cambridge and in general in academia, you will develop your experimental or theoretical skills, and these will be things that will be valued in industry. You will also expose yourself to the community by giving talks or presenting papers. You'll be evaluated by the output, the scientific output, and collaborations, interaction, networking is very important. That's in academia, but as well in industry. Everything that you do in this space will also be valuable in industry. But in an industrial environment, you may find additional things, some differences that you may not see so much in academia. First of all, I come from a large corporation, so it's not a startup. The Hitachi is a very big company. And you should expect, if you join us to do research in a large corporate environment, which will allow you to interact with the researchers, not only in the quantum computing or quantum technology space, but with many, many researchers across the world that are doing breakthrough research. In Hitachi, you will have freedom to do your own research. So when I came and joined the company, I asked, what should I do on the first day? And they told me, do something useful for the company. So it was very broad, but you can see what they were looking for. Some breakthrough research, so look at very complicated problems, but problems that the company was interested in. So you really needed to care about your employer, about your customer, potential customer. So this is a very important aspect of working at Hitachi. And also that you will need to focus your research. So when we are in academia, you can start your research program, and then if you find something interesting, divert and start exploring that idea. But in a company, you really need to focus. You need to decide what you're gonna do. You wanna develop a technology. There are many physics experiments that you can do on the way to develop that technology, but you need to stop, step aside and say, look, my goal is the development of the technology. I may be able to do those physics experiments at another point. Something important is the aspect of patents. So in academia, you will be as well exposed to the possibility of patenting your ideas. But in a corporate environment, this is much more important. So you should expect that if you come up with a very nice idea, you will go through an IP process in which you will write an invention disclosure, you will communicate with patent attorneys, you will file that patent, and then at that point, you can publish. There will be other ideas that do not need IP protection, and then you can go ahead with a publication process, but you always should think how to make your idea a potential product. And something that is quite important is collaboration. This is important generally in research, but in an industrial environment, it also becomes very important because a company cannot cover every single field, every single aspect. It's impossible for a company to do that. So the role of researchers, industrial researchers like us, is to be able to interact with researchers at universities that are doing forefront research and join their efforts and help them develop that technology. So you may have heard that for academics it's very important to collaborate with industry, but the other way around it's the same. It's very important for us to collaborate with academics. So a little bit about Hitachi. So it's a very large corporation with almost 1,000 different companies, almost 400,000 employees, and a turnover of $17 billion a year. And in terms of research, research is distributed in several centers, the Center for Social Innovation, where the innovation comes from the collaboration with potential customers. So the company approaches customers, say, what is your problem? We will try to find a solution for that. Then we have the Center for Technology Innovation, where we have breakthrough technology could potentially lead to applications or solutions, and this is what drives the research. And then finally, we have the Center for Exploratory Research, where I am, and we look at fundamental research concepts for paradigm shifts. So you can see a very broad spectrum. The Hitachi Cambridge Laboratory is at the very end of the fundamental side of things. So in Europe, there are several laboratories, several R&D laboratories. We have the Transportation, Energy and Environment Lab in London. We have the Automotive and Industry Lab in Sofia Antipolis and in Munich. We have the European Big Data Lab and Experience Design Lab in London as well as in Copenhagen. And the one I'll be talking about is the Hitachi Cambridge Laboratory, which is located within the premises of the Department of Physics of the university. And we look at quantum computing, quantum optics, and biosensing. So the lab itself is inside the Cavendish Laboratory, and we have a very close collaboration with researchers. Our motto is that we should strive for open innovation, so everything that we do in the Hitachi Laboratory, all the equipment that we provide, is also open for university researchers, and in the same way, equipment from the university is open to us to use. So we have a very close collaboration with the Microelectronics Group at the University of Cambridge that is materialized typically by having common projects, academic industry projects, in which a PhD student will be the bridge, will be the link between those two. At the moment, we are 10 different researchers working in different topics. As I was saying, we have the area of quantum optics, so if you are interested, you can come later and talk to me, but this is not the area I lead. There is biosensing, there is as well optospintronics concepts that we explore, and the topic that I would like to tell you a little bit more about is quantum information processing, which is the area that I lead. So what we try to do at the Hitachi Cambridge Lab is develop the hardware of the future quantum computer. So we are experimentalists, mainly physicists, but now we are recruiting more and more engineers. And we want to develop a scalable solution for quantum computers that is based on the mainstream silicon technology that we use in our laptops, in our mobile phones, in our PCs. So during the day, you will hear about different technologies that are being explored for scalable quantum computers. You will hear about superconductors, ion traps, photonic qubits, and silicon spin qubits as some of the major candidates for building a quantum computer. But all those technologies, even our technology, faces a major challenge, which is the scalability challenge. How do we go from very small processors to processors with sufficient number of resources, sufficient number of qubits, such as we can compute, we can enable those pieces of software that the startups that I've already presented are developing. So the hardware is everything, as Dr. Sandler was saying just before, and this is the area that we focus on. So you could take these technologies from experimental labs, and for example, a strategy will be to approach the semiconductor industry and tell them, can you take these processes into mass scale production and integrate many, many more of those components into the same sample space? The thing is that the semiconductor industry has become so powerful because they are they don't like to change their processes. They are very good at what they do. They just want to have incrementally better processes. So there's another approach. Why don't we take something that already exists in the semiconductor industry, modify it as little as possible, and try to make a quantum computer out of it? And this is what we do at the Hitachi Cambridge Lab. We take a transistor. You probably are familiar with the structure of a transistor. It's a digital switch or an analog amplifier. And we modify very little. This is an example, a picture of a transistor that we use for our experiments. This is our basic building block. This is our qubit. It's a four-terminal device, source and drain, omni-contacts, and two gates. In a regular transistor, you would just have one gate. All our experiments need to be done at very low temperatures, millikelvin temperatures. And the benefits of using this technology is that this is fabricated in a CMOS platform, in the semiconductor fabrication environment. It will be easy to integrate with conventional electronics. And spins in silicon present very long coherence times. They are ideal candidates for memories. So just to let you know a little bit more about the structure, if we take a cut along the direction of this line, then I will explain how this technology works. At very low temperatures, by applying potentials on these metallic gates, we can trap single electrons under these gates in the silicon lattice. We are going to call this spin our qubit spin, and we are going to call that one our readout spin. And what we do is we use this gate to read the spin orientation of this qubit, and we use this other gate to manipulate, to write the quantum information by using electromagnetic pulses on that gate. And why do we love this technology? Because it is scalable in the one dimension, and now we have prototypes for the scalability in the second dimension. So you can see our basic building block now stacked into a one-dimensional chain of these split-gate transistors, as we know. So if I have time, I'll show you a video of how our machine works. So this is a standard transistor, silicon nanowire transistor that you may find in some technologies nowadays. And when you apply a voltage, you can see the current flowing through the device. When you don't, the current stopped. So these are digital switches. These are normal transistor. So we just modified a little bit, remove part of the gate in between so we can bias each gate independently. We apply an external magnetic field and then potential voltages here that allow us to load a single electron at very low temperatures, millikelvin, under each gate. This is going to be our qubit spin. This is going to be our readout spin. And from basic physics, because of the Pauli exclusion principle, if we manipulate one of the spins with this electron speed resonant technique, and then we try, so we are manipulating the spin with ESR techniques, spin up, spin down, a superposition of states, and then if, for example, we write a zero, and then we try to project it onto this other spin, that's not going to happen. Fermions cannot have exactly the same quantum numbers, so this is a forbidden transition. But if we rotate into the one state, these spins can be together in the same location of space, that transforms a charge motion that we can effectively detect. Then we can put two of these transistors together and then use the two qubit spins at the top to perform a two qubit gate, the final ingredient that is not common in classical computing. So we have one spin, another spin, and then we are going to use exchange as our two qubit gate. So we do a one qubit gate, we bring these spins together to activate the exchange interaction, then the spin rotates in the reference frame of the other spin at certain speed, single qubit gate, and then we've rotated that spin depending on the state of this one. There can be another situation in which we start with a spin up orientation here, and then single qubit gate, exchange interaction, now it's gonna rotate at a different speed, and then if we do a single qubit gate, we end up in the same state as we started. So this is what is known as a control knot gate. This is the essential element of quantum computing, an entangling gate that allows you to operate on two qubit systems. Good. So one final point to discuss is about the team. So this is not the work of a single person, not even the work only of Hitachi. But in Hitachi, we have several research scientists working on this project, primarily my colleagues Sun-Ye Yang and Lisa Iverson, and we have a very good number of PhD students from different universities. In fact, there is one of your colleagues, David Iverson, that is about to finish, that has done an amazing job. He's going to get possibly 5 papers out of his PhD, and he's writing a very, very impactful paper demonstrating the fastest readout method for silicon-based quantum computers. So there's a possibility to engage with the company at the PhD level, and then we also have some students that have already graduated, and for example, Simon Sal is going to move to Intel, and Intias is already a professor in Bangladesh. So we have several student projects. We have the SpinQubit team, in which we have 2 students. Theodore will finish also soon, so there will be a vacancy on demonstrating dynamics concept of spin qubits in silicon. We have the other team. Simon has just moved, so there is a possibility to do something there, in which we send designs to silicon foundries. We get those devices made with standard silicon fabrication processes. We put those chips at millikelvin temperatures, and we can do quantum computing experiments with them. David on the readout side, and then a very new project with Giovanni on using machine learning concepts to automate the initialization process of our quantum machines. We publish well, so you should also expect to get good publications of PhD with us, and also the possibility to move around the world to collaborate with different institutions across the world. For example, in Tokyo, our very colleagues in France, the facilities of nanofabrication facilities at IMEC, etc. Good, so if you have any questions, please go ahead. Either maybe I use all the time, but if not, later. Yeah.
I think collectively all of Cohort 4's hearts dropped then when we saw that the entire presentation was going to be a video, but it was okay. Right, so we've got some time now for some questions from the audience. Oh,
we've
got a question just
there. I can just speak out loud. How do you ensure that you only have one qubit under these contacts? So how are you managing that?
So the first thing that you need to take care of is the dimensions of your structure. So the first thing that is going to determine whether you are going to form a single quantum dot under those gates is the physical dimension. So we went through a process of trying different sizes for the transistors. These transistors are not very small, actually. Now the semiconductor industry can do 7 nanometer node. The length scale of this transistor is 40 nanometers minimum. You will use 60, 40 nanometers.
You create some sort of potential.
And you create a potential well under the gate. Sometimes there are irregularities, so we need to do a variability study, because instead of having one, you may have 2. So this is something that is we don't do. We don't do the fabrication part, but it's something that we can influence by giving information on the statistics of the devices, what needs to be changed in the fabrication process to improve it.
Thank you. Any other questions?
It's becoming more and more common. Interestingly, Hitachi is one of the first corporations that entered the academic environment here in the UK. And it was interesting also because at that time in Japan, it was not allowed for corporations to collaborate with industry. It was forbidden. But now see, sorry, with academia. But now see how things have changed, that the industry is strongly encouraged to collaborate with academia and the other way around. So you will find more and more companies that find small groups, 3-4 people in a particular department, to collaborate with the existing academics to develop some particular piece of research.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, yes. We can talk later. I can give you a few. We use Python. First of all, we use Python for data acquisition. It's the best coding language now for data acquisition as well. and then it's very easy to implement machine learning models on your data. The idea is that as you scale up the quantum computer, it becomes a multidimensional problem, so you have to find all these voltages that you need to apply on your gates. You can do it manually, and this is the way it's been done until now, but when it becomes such a large multidimensional process, it takes a very long time. So what we do is, first of all, we have a part of the project that is image recognition, so your data is going to have a particular structure. When you plot it, depending on the conditions of your computers. In neural networks, yeah.
I have a completely different question. I was just wondering, because you were talking about collaboration between companies and academia, how does a company like yours deal with conflict between intellectual property and publication?
Yeah, so at the beginning, this is set up very clear in a contract between the, our company and academia. So typically, we start with a non-disclosure agreement, which basically says, if you want to present your results, you just need to tell us, which I think is also common in an academic environment. But then this will be contractual. If in terms of IP, there are several mechanisms. A typical mechanism is just to decide, okay, all the results that come from this collaboration will be joint IP, if you would like to. That's one approach. The other approach is to consider who has had the most contribution, because sometimes this is easy to evaluate. So for example, you say, if this partner has contributed 70% to this particular idea, this can be, if they want, their own IP, and vice versa.
And also in a slightly different context, I mean, there might be an interest from a big company to not publish the entirety of the results because they're making money with it, right? But in academia, we might be very interested in publishing everything so somebody else can continue working on it. How does that conflict play out?
So generally, this is true in the space of quantum technologies and quantum computing particularly, because this is very new. This is still fundamental research. There is no will to do anything like this because quantum computing, at least the development of the hardware, is such a complicated task. It's very difficult. That is inconceivable that a single corporation, even as large as Hitachi, could tackle that problem on their own. So at the moment, everything's open. Everything that we do in our laboratory, we publish.
I think we've just run out of time for questions, but please come and find Dr. Zalba during lunches and dinners if you want any further questions.
Thank you.
Just a short note, when attendees are asking questions, could we just make sure to use the microphone just for recording purposes and to make sure that everyone can hear the question? So, our last